Now that we know where we stand in this world, it's time for Jesus, it's time for truth to make its move for sure. We literally live in, we're in a state of global martial law right at this point. Already we're in global martial law. There is now a global agreement, 193 nations have agreed to put forth this massive bureaucracy through the United Nations to police and combat all forms of extremism, what they call extremism. Okay, this is really global martial law. If you know martial law, a dictator takes over and then they claim that anyone who opposes them is an extremist. Okay, then they put this police state apparatus in place. This has now happened on a global scale. This planet is under martial law. It's a police planet. It's an apostate planet living here in the Bay Area, which is a den of iniquity. Nature-worshipping, goddess-worshipping witches here. Living in California, which is an apostate state for sure. Terrible place, actually, spiritually. I can tell you this is the guts of the New World Order. This is what is spread throughout the world. And the United Nations has given sanction to use any and all technology now to implement this global martial law. It's in the Resolution 2178 that all technology should be pushed now, brought to bear in every way possible to combat global extremism. Extremism being a very amorphous term, of course. Whatever the goddess worshipping, death worshipping, hallucinators really, nature worshipping hallucinators, antichrist, whatever they deem as extremist, is caught up in this rubric of martial law, global martial law. Keep in mind that the truth is, nature as we see it doesn't really exist. It's an hallucination, actually. The idea of process does not exist. Space and time don't really exist. God did not create space or time or nature or processes or form, any of that. So what is real is real. What was not real doesn't exist, actually. It's a hiding place that we are desiring as an appearance. Now, the nature-worshipping, goddess-worshipping, heathen, pagan, idolatrous, antichrist, witches, so to speak, this is an expression of our continuity fear. Our continuity fear. We're afraid that reality is too good for us. So we want something opposite, some way to hide from this. And this is what we get, this horrible, horrible world, actually. And so we're in this time, right at this day, we're in this time, which is actually a very good time. The dreams I'm having are tremendous. Jesus is doing something tremendous for those who have truly repented and have turned away and said, you know what? This is not an expression of God. This world is not an expression of God. Not really. It's an attempt to turn our back on God. And we don't really want it. Okay. We're not faithful or loyal to nature. And the reason why this apostate martial law world is worshiping the goddess nature is because intrinsically we believe that the feminine, the woman, is closer to nature, more in tune with nature, producing the flesh, the one that produces the flesh, the form. And so we feel that intrinsically we can stay bound to nature better if we put the goddess in charge, if the feminine is in charge of this planet, the ideology of this planet, then we will better kowtow to nature and therefore keep hiding from God, you see. this is, it's very simple, actually, what's going on. And of course, those who don't want to hide from God, don't want any part of this new world order, this goddess-worshipping, nature-worshipping, pagan heathen, apostate, martial law, new world order, don't want anything to do with it. It's just delay. It's just a severe delaying tactic. These people would rather worship dogs than worship God. I'm telling you this. I live in the belly of this beast. It's horrible, 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 living in the Bay Area. The Bay Area, they insist it's the best place in the world. It's probably the worst place in the world. The attitude here is so heathen, so pagan. I was hijacked by the heathen pagans. Out of promise I'd be able to produce music, beautiful music. Of course, they wanted to use that to attract people to nature worship. And of course, musicians are the stupidest people in the world because they're for the sake of music, which they love so much, they don't really care who they're serving as long as they're able to work at their music. And this is the problem with musicians, is they generally do get usurped and pulled into the camp of the pagans, because the pagans love music so much, you see, and then they end up making music, and they don't realize, they don't really think about, well, who's appreciating it. They say, well, as long as someone appreciates it, that's all that counts. That is not true. So if anyone is liable to make a deal with the devil, it's musicians. That is a fact. And they certainly come to regret this, as I certainly have. And, you know, I put a kibosh on it and said, wow, and music is not God, you know. Absolutely is not. So I dropped music. So, the focus is what happens now? What happens now? I'm trying to. I was very clear about this morning. So the clarity is there. It's just gotten a little fuzzy because I got into the day a little too much. We get to learn about what love really is. What is love really? Love, forgiveness is the way. Forgive ourselves for worshiping our projections, worshiping idols, making these mistakes out of our continuity fear. All mistakes are from our continuity fear. In no way are we the body. In no way are we the product of what we see as nature, form, appearance. In no way are we the product or the offspring or the creation of appearance. In absolutely no way is this true. You see? So we are not bound by nature in the slightest bit, not even in the tiniest bit. Or is what we are dependent on nature, or bound by nature, or defined by nature in the slightest bit. In fact, because this is true, there is no nature. Nature is just this ridiculous concept of wanting to be able to define what we are, you know, to hide from reality. And when we give up this, you know, this fear, then we don't need to keep hallucinating that there is some such thing as process. And therefore, ultimately, there's no nature at all. There's no universe at all. None of that exists. So we have a choice now, very clear-cut choice. Do we continue on the path of repentance, which Jesus has made us aware of, It's a universal path. It's for everyone. And do we continue to evaporate our continuity fear, our deepest fears, and realize that reality will not overwhelm us? In fact, we'll feel fine. We'll feel very comfortable there. We just have to gradually, you know, get over this fear. Or do we decide to be a stalwart of this apostate world, which it is now? It is an apostate planet. This was predicted. This was foreseen. Jesus pointed out this planet would become an apostate planet at the end of this age. And that has now already happened. That's already in the rearview mirror. So at this point, we're entirely justified to make a choice and make a decision. What do we want? Do we want to attend the seminars and symposiums that Jesus is putting on to start this reacquaintance, you know, to accelerate the reacquaintance with truth and reality? Or do we want to go on with this devil-worshipping, horrible apostate world? And now, from being in the belly of the beast, I am reporting and witnessing to you how awful it truly is. There's nothing more abhorrent than the worshiping of the flesh, as we see in the Bay Area, where the women here are acting like these pagan goddesses, truly, and they walk around in such incredible immodest attitudes and behavior and arrogance, and it's repellent, it's sickening, it is truly repulsive. Yeah, you just want to say no more. Pagan society, heathen society is truly repulsive to spirit. And eventually, you know, you feel that the gloss wears off, and it's just revolting. And this is the ideology of the planet, the ideology of the world. There's no question about this. This is not what we want. We don't want to live on images, okay? All that this world has to offer us is images. Can you drink an image of water? No. And after a while, an image of water becomes repulsive because you realize it's fake. It's not what you really want. So we definitely need, you know, pep talks, which I'm capable of giving. For some reason, I feel a little bit reticent at the moment. But it will arise for sure. I'm just trying to put it in the right context here. Of course, we're scared. The world's scared now because they think, well, what if we don't get help? What if we don't get help? Well, we have been promised help. That is very true. And the thing is, if we go with Christ, the truth, Spirit, the witches will say, well, you'll never be able to be born again, you'll have no home forever, because they think nature is our home. They say, we ban you, we're going to curse you forever, that nature will never support your appearing. There is no such thing as nature. So what are they talking about? Just gibberish, actually. Nature is just a play of appearance that we are desiring moment by moment. There is no such thing as connected moments. There is no such thing as form or time or space, actually. Not at all. They have never existed and never will exist. So what they're basically saying is what has never existed and never will exist is going to refuse to support your being. So ultimately, it's very funny. It's very humorous. And we'll all have a very good laugh about it. And I'm not condemning anyone who's caught in this, because I'm saying it's all based on their continuity fear, and they will repent also. I feel like putting some big cross with an LED display saying repent, blinking on it, and driving throughout the Bay Area and just, you know, showing. I wish everyone in the world would come to the Bay Area with crosses, says repent on it, and just like circumnavigate the Bay Area, you know, like a circumnavigation along the freeways and throughout all the cities in this area, and just carry your crosses and say repent. How about, like, you know, 10 million Christians come to the Bay Area and carry crosses saying repent, repent, and flood the whole area with, you know, crosses of repentance. That would be great. That would be wonderful. That would be something that the whole, you know, would just bring tears of joy to all to spirit, for sure. And do that, then you could go to Los Angeles, Hollywood, and flood the area with maybe 100 million Christians in Hollywood with repent, repent, repent. Because that is what all these dear spirits need to hear. They are truly in need of this. The world is in need of the message of repentance, for sure. I've been trying to bring this message of repentance, but it maybe at some point a tremendous show of solidarity. Now, is that going to happen? I don't know. I kind of doubt it. They'd probably arrest everyone they could. I mean, if you walk downtown where I live with a big cross, LED light flashing, repent, it's almost for sure you'd be arrested. The cross would be confiscated, and you'd be charged with all sorts of crimes. Nobody's doing it. 10 years ago, I saw a street preacher, street preaching downtown. It was the last I ever saw of anything here. They found a way to get rid of him, for sure. But it would be interesting. You never see any iconography of the cross of repent here at all. Never. It's something you're supposed to hide in your closet, you know, as a shameful sign of your insanity here. This is true. I'm telling you, it's worse than you can imagine. It is worse than you can imagine here. It's like reporting from the front lines of some hideous, you know, war, actually. It's worse than that. It goes to spiritual war. And you just see the, you know, the devastation, spiritual devastation that's taking place in the Bay Area in California. As spirits place their faith in what doesn't exist and expect to reach a stable outcome from that, and to expect to reach true happiness from that, and of course, you know, they're holding nothing, they're clutching nothing, hoping that it's everything for them. And so it's very sad, very sad, very, very sad. But the attitude here is defiantly, absolutely defiant. And I'm completely tired of it. Completely tired of it. You know, if Jesus can resurrect Lazarus from the dead, Jesus can get me out of California, you know. I don't know how, but he, great God, grace of God, can do it. Get us out of this world, actually. Get us out of this world. It is a martial law world now. This is very important distress. The message of repentance will have to be carried to these heathens who, nature-worshipping heathens, in other words, are worshipping nothing. They're worshipping nothingness, not even no thingness, but simply they're worshipping the belief that there's something other than reality. That's what they're really doing. They're worshipping the belief that there's something other than reality. Well, there isn't anything other than reality. They're worshiping the belief that there's some place other than everywhere. There isn't any place other than every point. So they will need apostles of truth to witness to them, to witness the message of repentance at some point. So it's better to take the seminar that Jesus is offering and, you know, truly get your bell rung, right? And get totally in tune with truth. Totally in tune with truth. So then you can, at some point, bring the message of repentance to an apostate world, because I guarantee you that the thrill wears off, okay? The thrill of heathenism and paganism, it wears off. It wears off. I can guarantee you that, having lived in California my whole life, which is the home of heathenism and paganism, we try so hard here to you know, stay involved with it, you know, doing anything and everything, but you get sick of it. You get sick of it. You can feel this inner revulsion. It's repulsive. It becomes repulsive. Then what do? You know, then of course you turn to the Holy Spirit, but you know, you're still like desperate, like, my gosh, isn't there no one, you know, witnessing? So I greatly appreciate the people, you know, the other places in the world, with their unabashed witnessing for salvation, for Christ, for, you know, and their willingness to speak up, because you can't speak up here in California. You can't. It's a police state here. And so, you know, just to hear somebody who seems free and unintimidated, you know, it's just like, we're like here in California saying, wow, what is it? Is that possible? It's like some rare animal we just discovered, you know, some unknown species. You know, somebody is like not afraid to speak up for Christ. Are you kidding? That is amazing. It's like that, really. We can't believe it's possible. It's not possible here. We live in a climate of severe intimidation and bullying here. All the name of tolerance, of course. It is so upside down and backwards, you cannot believe it. It's a very unhappy place to live. Yeah. Oh yeah, the weather's great, but our spirit is absolutely miserable. The heathen animalistic nature of this planet, which happens when you turn away from truth and you want to hide from God. What better way to hide from God than to pretend you're an animal? You know? Right? That somehow you're just a product of nature. Not even animals are products of nature, but they give a better... They give a better fake job than humans do, right? Because humans actually give evidence of some higher reasoning, right? But what's happening now on this planet is an overall collective global martial law state which says that everybody has to pretend to be animals, human animals, here. So we can all collectively, together, cooperate in hiding from God. Keep in mind that heathens cooperate like crazy. They cooperate in their desperate, fearful attempt to hide from reality. Very cooperative in that. They're very unified in that. And they think that's a sign of how great they are. They're unified in their fear, their collective fear. Yeah, they all agree that we're all terrified of being overwhelmed by reality, being overwhelmed by how wonderful it is, actually. So we say, oh, we don't need how wonderful reality is. We got wonderful California beaches and Hollywood and mountains and, you know, and all these pagan goddesses strutting around, you know, these strumpets here in California. It's pathetic, actually. Revolting. And so they say, yeah, we're happy here. This is great. We don't need the happiness of reality. You know. How long does that last? Not very long. And then when that wears off, then the real fear sets in. You see, when all the delights of fake delights of glamour and glitter wear off, which in living in California, you're exposed to all the glamour and the glitz and the fake happiness. When that wears off, what do you do then? What do you do then? Then you're in big trouble. You see what I'm saying? And it certainly does wear off. Then you get these actors and actresses in Hollywood committing suicide is what they do. That's what happens. I mean, you know, these comedians can only tell so many jokes, and finally it doesn't work anymore. You know, they can only be the cheerleaders for wickedness for only so long, for depravity, for delusion only so long. And then, the jokes don't make them laugh anymore. And then what do? Being without any message of repentance, you know, commit suicide. So heathen society is a suicidal culture. There's no question about it. It's intrinsically suicidal. And yet they reject the message of repentance, which would save them. Now, fortunately, I'm one of the fortunate ones that I got the message of salvation. Somehow it seeped into me. And I certainly credit Christianity with that. I also give credit to the other religions in the world too, because they also played a role in repentance. You know, repentance. Because again, there's only one God, and that God is true for everyone, for all. This God is formless, it is nameless, it is zero-dimensional, pure spaciousness, it is all-inclusive, it has no preferences for what arises and appearances. It is total love, formless love. And so there's not two gods, there's just one. And so all of us can and will repent. And so there's repentant spirits everywhere in this planet from all different traditions, okay? And so that all helps, it all helps. True piety is piety. True modesty is true modesty. Okay. The heathens have tried to separate and create enmity between, you know, those who are repenting throughout the world and say, no, you try to create conflict between them. And then claim that all religion's bad because they're conflicted or something. But it's the fearful heathen mindset that tries to sabotage and create conflict. Divide and conquer is how fear works. Divide and conquer. I know that there's many prophets who say California is going to fall to the ocean. Huge earthquakes fall in the ocean. It's already fallen into the ocean. it's spiritually, it's already fallen into the ocean. It's already submerged. And it's like living in a sewer. I feel contaminated. You know, I feel like I need to be decontaminated. Really. And I drive around, I just cringe now. I just cringe. Who's that? Oh, God. You know, go to a grocery store and I'm just cringing. I mean, the women come in there, they look like they're working in a strip club. You know, that's how bad it is. It's horrible. And just their attitudes are so heathen. You know, you just say, oh my God, you know, I'm in some kind of nightmare. And of course, they think that they're doing you a favor. They're making you happy. Look how sexy I am. Look how attractive this body, nature is. Look what nature has done with my body. Isn't this amazing? And you just say, oh, it's just hideous. You know, it's a rotting corpse with makeup on. You know, and I'm supposed to think how wonderful that is. You know, it's a hideous thing. We're talking about eternal life and the happiness of eternal life. And here they're saying, look how beautiful death is. Look how beautiful rotting flesh is, can be. Is that right? That's what it is. It's rotting flesh pretending to be something fresh and beautiful. Yeah, and that's revolting. Truly revolting. So I've taken to, you know, like shopping, like late at night. There's nobody in the store. You go in the daytime and it's just like, whoa. You know, you have to avert your eyes. You really have to avert your eyes. You can't believe how bad it is in California. And of course the heathens love it. They love coming here because the heathen attitudes of the women here are so terrible. And you know, the heathen attitude is like, wow, look at all the beautiful women. It's incredible. Everywhere they go, they just go out walking, just, oh my gosh, you know. But when it becomes truly revolting, as it really is, then, you know, you don't want to be here. You do not want to be here. That is a fact. And for one who truly is waking up, you know, it's just, you find it to be utterly repellent to the nth degree. You know, you say, if I never see this again, that would be great. And this attitude, of course, is all through Hollywood, all through commercials, advertising, programs, you know, just blanketing the planet. It's an apostate world right now. So, still having trouble getting to what Jesus is going to do. Certainly, leaving the world is an option. Now, the pagans, it freaks them out because they're here to hide from God. The idea that there's someplace else that they're not in control of completely freaks them out. Terrifies them. And remember, they're here to say, hey, look how happy I am being a human animal. This is what I am. I'm not spirit. They say, I'm not spirit. God doesn't exist. I'm a human animal. I'm part of nature. This is reality. This is my home. There isn't anything else. And I'm totally in control of the situation. And we're making it illegal for any other ideology. And they're like super happy. We have this global police, martial law police state now. Ideological police state. They think this is the greatest thing that ever happened to them. So the idea that Jesus has some plant, some dwelling place somewhere we can go to, is like the worst anathema to them possible. This is like the worst nightmare ever for them. It is the one thing they absolutely don't want to hear. Okay? This is a fact. If you could pick one thing that the heathens would simply find the most revolting thing possible, is to say that Jesus has manifested a dwelling place for us. He will take those of us on this apostate martial law planet to go to his dwelling place, and where we have this symposium, seminar on love. And he will train us there so that we can eventually witness, be a witness to repentance for this apostate planet and others, to help out the heathens who eventually will get absolutely, to help out spirits who eventually get completely sick of heathenism. And becomes very suicidal, actually. This is the one thing that causes them to just... it's like kryptonite to them. They can't stand the idea. Which is why it's not being talked about. Because we're all trying... They're saying, hey, we all need to get along here. We all need to... In other words, don't cause the heathens to get upset, is what they're really saying. But the very thing that they need to help them is the very thing that they're most opposed to, and they say you can't talk about it at all. Imagine if you're in like school now and you're talking about, yeah, Jesus is going to come back and take those who want to go to his planet, and you know, he lives and today, and he's talked with me and visited with me, and they say, you know, they would expel you from school. You can't say anything like that in school. That's how scared they are. We live in a phobic world, a Jesus-phobic world, Christophobic world, salvation-phobic world, a repentophobic world. We live in an extremely repentophobic world. If you want to talk about these phobias, this is repentophobic. You know, the world is now repentophobic. Repentophobic, Christophobic, repentophobic. That's a good one, isn't it? You know, so these repentophobic heathens can't stand this notion. In fact, they say it's an impossibility. It's worse than that. It's their worst nightmare. And it's true, it is their worst nightmare in the short term, in the way, their way of looking at it. But it's their greatest hope, because I guarantee you, heathenism leads to suicide. Okay? Guaranteed. You have a whole planet that's gone apostate heathen, and you have a suicidal planet. And a suicidal planet can bring about, if it's globally, it's not just one person, they can bring about the suicide of this planet, actually. They can bring about a global catastrophe in this world. And indeed, in the Bible, it says that's what will happen. In fact, Jesus said, there will be such a bad catastrophe on this planet that if the grace of God doesn't step in some way, no life will be spared on this planet. That means even microbes, okay, nothing. That's how bad it is. That's how bad it is. We're told that's how bad it is. So this is what happens, you know, in so what spirit needs is those who really are truly accept what love really is. And you can only best get that from those who do know, such as Jesus, those who do know. And give it a fair hearing. Find out. And then that's how you are helpful later on, when the thrill is gone. When the thrill is gone. And I'm telling you, when the thrill leaves you, it really leaves you, and you can't go back. And then you just shudder with abhorrence at all the stuff that you thought was so wonderful, all this pagan eye candy and glitter and gloss of the flesh. You shudder at it, and you don't know how to escape it. You know, you just feel trapped. It's the Hollywood syndrome, all the actors, actors ODing on drugs. The whole planet is going to be like that. The whole planet's going to be Planet Hollywood. This world is going to be Planet Hollywood. Everybody's going to be ODing on drugs, okay? Because the message of repentance will be, you know, excommunicated from this planet. and that's okay, but this is the phase. Once the thrill is gone, then there'll be this desperate need here. Desperate need. Whether here or wherever these spirits are, for the message of repentance to be carried to them. Carried to them. Now, we know, like, there when Christian missionaries went into the deepest, darkest hearts of paganism and heathenism, trying to bring the gospel of repentance and salvation there, they made some headway for a while, it seemed, but then the heathen ways would come back, and at some point they would start projecting and scapegoating the missionaries and saying, you know, you've broken our taboos, that's why bad things are happening to us, you know, and you're to blame, and they go crazy. And there's times when the missionaries have to pull out and say, okay, it's time to back off for a little while. This is normal. This is the phases. Our continuity fear is so severe that we go through phases in evaporating it. There are phases. And there are phases when you tend to go back into heathenism saying, wait a minute, let me, it's like last call at the bar, you know, where people realize the bar is being shut down, about ready to be shut down, and they say, well, wait a minute, you know, let me just, and they just start drinking like fish, and they just go wacko for a while. And this is what the world is going through right now. It's going to go wacko. It already has gone wacko. Totally wacko. The whole world is drinking like fish now of the false gospel. Okay, of the Luciferian false gospel. And so it's time for the missionaries to pull out for a while, to leave. decontaminate themselves and get reaffirmed and re-clarified and truly established in what love really is, how love really works. You see? And so they can then bring that message of repentance in its true clarity, in its true potency, in its truth, fullness of the truth of that, to those spirits who actually will be very, very receptive at some point in the future. Very receptive. Because once the thrill is gone, like I said, and you've been through this hellish depression and suicidal depression, your ears are wide open. And you say, I want the truth, and I'm not going to stop till I get it. So we had better be really, really enlightened and established in the grace of God for such a role. Otherwise, they'll get angry. You better be able to walk the walk and talk the talk in the future, because there'll be a need for that. So, you know, for me, I just say, hey, you know, I understand the situation, so I better be spot on in the future. Better be spot on, because they're going to demand. They're going to say, hey, we're not going back. So, you know, we're going to insist that you preach the true gospel. So that's coming up rather soon, actually. It's coming up rather soon. This phase won't last long. This falling in love with the absence of God doesn't last very long. It's a very short honeymoon, you know. So we're in this honeymoon period, this pagan honeymoon period right now, okay. But you know what will happen. It's like, yeah, so it's stupid to not prepare for that. It's stupid to not prepare for that. So who cares how the honeymoon period is for this paganism, you know. They'll have their fireworks and everything. But once the thrill is gone, you know, they're going to be just sunk in this abject condition, really. I'm telling you, the spirit can only take music. Music can only buoy you up for so long. All this stuff can only buoy you up for so long. And you reach this point where you just sunk into this feeling of almost oblivion. It's horrible. And the message of repentance is like the most beautiful song you've ever heard. You say, oh my gosh, you know, all this pagan music was nothing compared to the message of repentance. And then you want to hear that song and say, where are these musicians? Where are these spiritual musicians? So my goal is to be a spiritual musician. So you need to go see the master spiritual musician who knows how to play hit the right notes. So this is how you play the game. You know, this is how you play the instrument. This is how it's done. You got to go listen to and learn from the teachers who know. I became a really great musician in a previous life by going to really great teachers, really great teachers. I had some of the best teachers possible. And they said, if you want to be truly a great piano player, this is how you do it. This is how you do it. They knew how it was done. So I did what they told me to do, and it worked. It worked. And people came to me and said, how in the world did you do it? How did you learn this? You know, it's the teachers, you know, they know. You have to understand the basics. You have to understand that the absolute simplicity of the whole thing. You have to be established in the clear simplicity of it all. And out of that, then, all these variations and everything, you know, it's just, you can just realize it's just icing on the cake. You're just throwing icing on the cake. You understand it? It's the cake that matters, really. The icing is just attraction, superficially, you know, attractive, actually. You don't lose sight of the sheer simplicity of it all. And the attraction, you understand, the real attraction is this great simplicity of it all. So yeah, the right teachers are all important, all important. Because the right teacher will say, no, you have to keep practicing that. I said, no, it's not, you don't have it yet. Practice some more. Yeah, but I've been doing that for 3-4 years. You still don't have it. Keep practicing it. And then at some point, you become it. You become it. You are it. You know, you are the music. It's not something you're thinking about. You know, it's hardwired into you. It's hardwired into you. So it becomes what you are. You have to reach that point. If you don't reach that point, you know, you're never going to really bring that gospel, that, you know, what you're bringing. You're never going to be able to really bring it. But of course, if you're hardwired as a musician, you're really going to suffer terribly, which I have gone through horribly. But you want to be hardwired as truth. And the thing is, we already are hardwired as truth. We're just afraid of that. So it's kind of like letting go of all the other hardwiring we've tried to, you know, hardwire ourselves with music and intellectualism and poetry and culture and recreation and glitz and glamour and acting and role playing and all this nonsense. None of that sticks. It's never a stable outcome. We're already hardwired for being, for oneness, for love. We're already there. So we just have to let go of all that other stuff. So you might call it an unlearning process, actually. We don't need any software. We are already the software of truth and love. We can never lose it. It's hardwired. It's just merely responsible to prepare for what's going to happen. It's just being responsible. You know, if you see it, for me, as I'm seeing it, how can I not go to Jesus' seminar on love? To refuse to do so would be incredibly irresponsible, because I know what's going to happen to all these, this heathenism, though, these wonderful spirits who are in this last call mode with heathenism, trying to make one last effort to make it work for them. You know, they're going to be suicidal. And they're going to be in this state of oblivion, thinking oblivion is the only answer. And so, you know, they're going to have to be witnessed to very immaculately. And you cannot have anything else interfering with this. The certainty has to shine through. Like a breeze of fresh air. You have to be the breeze. You have to be that fresh breeze. They're in a state of a stagnation that they feel is oblivion. So knowing how this ends up, it would be incredibly hateful and irresponsible to not prepare for it properly, to be helpful. You know, it's like if you're a doctor and you know there's some severe contagion coming, you'd be irresponsible to not prepare for it, right? It wouldn't be responsible to tell people what they need to do to avoid this contagion, or get ready to, you know, help administer to the sick. So this is how I look at it. It's an absolute necessity to avoid just abject, hateful irresponsibility to go to the Jesus' seminar. Absolutely. And so this is what I'm finally getting to in the video. This is the right attitude to have. Now, of course, the last call at bar was roaring, smashed, and you tell them, hey, you're going to have a severe hangover tomorrow, and I'm going to have to help you with that hangover. They're going to jeer at you and mock and spit on you and say you're crazy and keep drinking, right? So they're saying, as long as I drink, I'm not having any hangover. That's the attitude of the drunk, right? You can't reason with them, can you? Cannot. You cannot. So temporarily, so you cannot ask for their blessings upon it, because of course they'll spit on you. So you have to do it unilaterally, and say, you know, look, as a you know, spiritual physician, it's my oath. You know, I took an oath to be helpful, and so I must be, you know, loyal to that oath, not loyal to some falling down drunks telling me what I'm supposed to do. You cannot have the insane telling you that they don't need any treatment, don't need any help. And of course, they're in their drunk state, so I'll never accept any help from Jesus or anyone that has anything to do with Jesus. I will never, ever, you know, that's just the drunkenness talking. When they're in the state of feeling oblivion of the suicidal depression, you know what? A nice breeze coming through, a spiritual breeze. They're going to say, what's that? They say, that Jesus? They'll say, I don't know, but all I do know is I like that. I like that. So, I want to pay attention to that. You get to some state where you know, all that boasting and bragging, you don't care about anymore. Heathens are very boastful. It's all braggadocio. It's all fear-based. You reach a point where you're no longer boastful. And you say, you know what? I can't afford to be boastful anymore. It's a realization. So that doesn't work. So I just think I can't afford it. You know, heathens never believe that they'll turn around and repent. They absolutely insist 100% it will never happen. And I guarantee you 100% it will happen in every case without exception. It's a certainty. So you cannot go with the braggadocio and believe in the braggadocio. And I tell Jesus this, I don't believe in the heathen, so you got to, Jesus. Somehow you have to make this happen. Because otherwise I'll be irresponsible, totally irresponsible. Now, of course, there's a tendency to listen to braggadocio just because you think, well, that'd be easy then. I mean, if they say they don't need it, and then you know, I don't have to put in all this work and effort, you know, but no, they will need it. And the amount of help that's needed is like overwhelming. It is frightening, you know. It's just like, wow, what's going to happen in this world? So many spirits going to need so much help. And it does seem to be overwhelming. But it is possible to establish a really huge relief effort. It is possible. Jesus even told me he doesn't need much help, really. He says it's not that difficult as you think. Just needs a few really good, solid cornerstones, you know. Because keep in mind that once the heathens repent, as they will, they're going to be very much desirous of sobering up. They're going to say, that's the last hangover ever. I'm never going to have a hangover like that again. And they'll be very determined. So it'll be an easy sell, actually. You just have to have the will to do it, you know. Have the forgiveness and the will to do it. Jesus, I spoke with him, and he was talking about, I think, the 2,000 years of his mission here. And he said, oh, yeah, those were great times. And he says, I just had a small group, you know. It wasn't many, actually. And he says, that's all I need. It wasn't difficult. I was surprised. I said, well, really? He said, yeah. It was just, you know, just bright light in the darkness, you know. A couple of big searchlights in the darkness is enough to dispel, you know, the effect of darkness for the multitudes, really. Because I'm thinking, hey, Jesus, there's not that many really that are really, you know, where they need to be. I mean, I don't want to have too much responsibility here. he says, no, don't worry. It's like a band, you know. How many band members do you need to produce great music, actually? Three, four? You know, some of the best bands have only three in the band, you know. Back in the day, like Cream, Led Zeppelin, Jimi Hendrix Experience, ZZ Top, you talk about all these, you know, bands. There were a lot of bands, and only three people in them. It's like, wow. How did they do that? How did Cream do it with three people? You know, it's just like, are you kidding me? Or a Jimi Hendrix Experience. Sometimes it even sounds better with only three. So you don't need a band, you don't need, like, you know, just multitudes. Sometimes the clarity comes through with just a few. Clarity really comes through with just a few. So I'm willing to give him a hearing, listen to what he has to say. Yeah. I've got some reservations because I know the task seems just almost overwhelming. Yeah, there's an apostate world. What's going to happen to all these spirits? They're going to have severe hangovers. Yeah. So my dread is too much responsibility. That's my dread. You know, it's like, wow. I don't want to be given too much responsibility. That's a big fear. But I guess if you know your business, it's not a problem. There are people who are CEOs of these gigantic multinational corporations, you know, and they can handle it. It's not a problem. I mean, they know their business. They know their business. You understand. And so it's not a problem, really. And so it is possible to get so much clarity and to free yourself from all continuity fear that you really know your business. And it's, you know, you don't make mistakes. It's smooth. So I believe it's possible to get to that, absolutely. So the more the better. I mean, it would certainly be nice to have, you know, more help to ease all the responsibility. So we'll see. I don't know. I really don't know. There should be a lot. I mean, I know Jesus is training a lot. Course in Miracles was a training for teachers of God. See, it was given out to this world to try to recruit, to train teachers of God. And Jesus needs them. He knows the hangover time is coming. All right? So, I took a Course in Miracles in 1978. I knew this is a course for teachers of God. And I knew I chose to be a teacher of God. And it says, I better get working on this fast because there's not much time. And it's a tough curriculum. I don't know where I stand at this point. You know, probably pretty lowly, I would think, because I've not really put it all together. But I'm willing to do my work. And the time is now is coming soon when the help will be needed. You see these people everywhere, so fat in America, you know? It's mind-blowing. All the time now. I'm looking around, I'm seeing someone in the car, and the person is like 450 pounds, they fill up the entire car, and they're just like, bloated so they can't even move. They're just living to eat. I mean, they're trying, you know, to make, turn themselves into an animal, human animal. They're reaching this oblivion. You know, it doesn't work. The thrill doesn't work anymore. Give them, you know, I just got to keep stuffing my face in. The thrill doesn't work anymore. You know, we're all blowing up like blimps. The pseudo-intellectuals are able to keep their slimness because they still think that you know, being in charge of an apostate world is like something that'll run, you know, float their boat for a while. Yeah, it floats their boat for a little longer, actually. Because they think they're being useful and working in harmony and unity and cooperation. And they're doing something that is like really great, organizing the apostate world. So they're able to hold out longer. But their depression's even worse. Their depression is even worse. And they go, you know, the feeling of oblivion becomes attenuated even worse. They're much tougher cases, that is for sure. whereas those who are just, you know, the heathens, just without being too much of a pseudo-intellectual, they can repent and get over their hangover and, you know, not as much trouble as the pseudo-intellectuals. They tend to be hard cases. But they too will repent eventually, just a little more delay. But the obesity is a sign. You know, I think people from other worlds, someone told me they went to some other countries or something and they couldn't believe how thin everybody was. Oh, so it was like England. Someone's in England right now. Says, where are all the fat people? Of course, the English, again, being pseudo-intellectuals, feel that their purpose is to help organize this pagan world, you know. So they can keep it going like that for a while. They're very much into that. They're quite hard cases to crack, for sure. No doubt about it. But they will repent also at some point, just a little bit down the road. And we will be able to help them at that point, no question about it. You know, in a sane asylum, there's always those who think that among the patients, who think that they're the ones actually running it, right? And so they pretend that they're the therapist. You know, they show up in the white coat, and you know, they're completely, you know, loopy, insane. But they pretend they carry a clipboard around, a white coat, and then they talk to the other patients and say, what seems to be bothering you today? And they kind of imitate, mimic the actual therapist. Okay, they're the pseudo-therapist. This is what happens in insane asylum. Everyone's playing roles there. They play roles. It's not like the people, you know, they're not like they're stupid. That's really is. It's insane is different. And so they'll be playing very sophisticated roles. You hear like the Napoleon, someone playing. They'll have to be dressed up like Napoleon, playing the general, looking over the troops. And you're saying, now troops, and there'll be a couple of people in there who will actually be pretending to be the troops. Yes, general. What are our orders today, general? And so there are those who pretend to be the therapists, and telling everybody, you know, how to. And of course the insane are pretending like these insane therapists are the therapists too, you know, and so the real therapists, you know, are having to help out with this. And so the patients, the ones who are role-playing being patients, of the one who are role-playing being the therapist, they're listening to the role-playing therapist and saying, "Yes, doctor, what is it that I need to do?" And the doctor will say, "Well, I think you need to go sit over there. I think you need to do some yoga today." And you say, "Yes, doctor, okay." So this is the world. As Anandamayi Ma said, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, who had no continuity of fear, said, "This world is literally an insane asylum." Literally an insane asylum. This is true. Because we have people playing the roles of patients, people playing the roles of therapists here. And the therapists are dishing out this ridiculous advice, and the patients are taking this ridiculous advice, and everybody thinks this is the answer, you know. So a real therapist comes here, and they have a, you know, difficult time. They say, "If you're a doctor, how come you're not saying what the other doctors are saying?" And you can't really say, "Well, those other doctors are just as insane as you are," because then they'll go, "Wait a minute. But, you know, what will happen to my role as a patient then?" Well, you keep the role as patient, you just listen to the right doctor, and they say, no. So you're really dealing with insanity here. And it's not easy. But it's doable. It's doable. The problem is you can't get sucked into thinking that you're one of these fake therapists, you know, in order to deal with these role-playing patients. You know, you get caught up in the insanity of it here. And that's, unless you're really free of continuity fear, you to some extent, you get pulled into this role-playing and insanity here. You know, this is, Jesus said, everything here is just actors, role-playing masks. That's it. He says, we're all passionately playing out these roles, which have nothing to do with reality whatsoever. And he said, eventually you'll all take off these masks of this role and have a good laugh at how wonderfully silly it all was, and then you'll put down the mask forever, and that'll be it. This is what he says. But you can imagine how tricky it is to talk to patients who are following the advice of these role-playing insane doctors. If they say, "Well, you didn't say what they're saying, and they're doctors, and how come you're disagreeing?" They say that, right? They say, "Why, you doctors, why don't you get your story straight? I mean, what's wrong with you?" You know. So the patients are turning the tables. See, they're very shrewd, the ones who are playing the role of patients. Remember, they're insane. They're playing the role of patients. It's just a role. You know, they think they're actually the sane ones, and the doctors are crazy. You see, well, they know the doctors are crazy. They don't realize they are, too. You know, they say, "Well, I'm just playing the role because the doctor needs me to play the role, this role." And the doctor says, "No, I'm only playing the role of doctor because the patient needs me to play this role." They don't ever put it together that both are playing roles out of continuity fear. And they say, "Well, who's going to be the doctor and who's going to be the patient then? We need this doctor-patient thing." I said, "No, well, why don't you both be the patients? You know, I'll be the doctor, you both be the patients," kind of thing, for now. Huh. Wow. And they start quiet about that one, you know. And they say, "Well, it was so much fun pretending to be sane when I wasn't insane." Well, actually, it wasn't that much fun, was it? They think about that for a while. This is called repentance. You say, "Yeah, well, no, it really wasn't that much fun, actually. It was like kind of crazy and confusing and fearful and angry." And then the patient says, "Yeah, but I had fun turning the tables on these fake doctors because it made me feel like I was more sane than they were." I say, "Yeah, well, was that really that much fun?" I say, "Not really. Yeah, did it make you happy? Not really. Because you're still insane, right? And is that was insanity happy just because you think someone else is more insane?" And then they say, "Not really, no. No, it's not really. No, it's not. This is repentance, this is honesty." Yeah, the game of following fake doctors, fake therapists, and then blaming them for your failure as an idea that as if that's going to make you happy. You know, eventually that game gets very tiresome because it doesn't cure the insanity, and so you're still terrified of the continuity fear of being overwhelmed by reality. So it doesn't work. So eventually you just say, wow, this whole role-playing thing is just, you know, it's terrible. Tired of it. Are there not any real therapists, you know? It's like that. You say, my God, I'm so tired of these fake therapists, insane therapists, who are just as crazy as I am. They're not helping me at all. So are there not any true therapists? Come on. And then you realize there are. And you say, wow, that's good news. That's gospel. That's good news. You start paying attention to them. And you start getting sobering up. And you wish it went faster. You know, you have a terrible hangover. You wish it's over, like, right now. Or if you eat, like, some super hot pepper. You know, you think, for, like, the first couple of minutes, you say, wow, this is really intense. This is weird. This is great. Oh, this is interesting. And then you say, okay, that's enough of the intensity. That's enough. And then I say, oh, it's not going away. The heat's not listening to me. I say, okay, that's enough. It's not listening to me. And then you say, oh, wow, I wish I hadn't eaten that pepper. Now, right now, if I wanted to, I could, this very day, this very moment, I could go drive, I could go to this garden that has the hottest peppers in the world, and I could come back with a bag of those peppers right today. I could do this right now. But I say, forget it. Forget it, forget it, forget it. Yeah, that's like heathenism. That's like paganism, right? Right now, you could get this whole bag of heathenism, you know, in California here. This is, you know, easy. And I say, no, forget it. Forget it. The novelty wears off and then the burn is still there. So you need to do a controlled burn. Okay? This is how you get sane. You do a controlled burn. Right? And then the wildfire of heathenism can't jump your fire break. You have a fire break. Then a controlled burn. And you've evaporated the continent of fear. You're intentionally freeing yourself from the pseudo-intellectualism of it, okay? Because this is what hooks you, because you think you can get into this role of the pseudo-intellectuals, and you're like above the heathenism or something. You're not really, but you seem to be functioning better within it, okay? This is the seduction of the world. So you really have to, as I said, work on the fourth phase exercises like your life dependent upon it. This is the real important fire break you have to do is conceptually. I give up all arrivals and I give up all non-arrivals. And I abandon all arrivals and all non-arrivals and relax into that. You know, this, the full stop in the burn is what you have to do to really keep this raging inferno, this raging inferno of heathenism. The heathen fires, they call wildfires, you know, some name, it's called the heathen fire. That is a global wildfire. The whole world's on fire right now, actually. You need this fire break. You need it. And so hopefully I can emphasize this more to people. I'm sure you need it. And of course we resist it because we think that if we can just align with the Illuminati, the leaders of this planet who are administering, the bureaucrats are administering and organizing all this, you know, will somehow have some immunity to it, you know. That's only temporary. It only seems temporary. It's kind of like the liquor, say, the bar that's selling all the liquor. They say, well, we're not drinking. Yeah, but the heathens are going to trash your bar, and their attitude is going to get into you eventually. You know, eventually you'll be stuck with a really severe headache. telling you that. So the temptation is to maintain your pseudo-intellectual stance with cleverness, with words, and saying, you know, I know I can control the heat, this wildfire. No, you're going to get burned by it. So you better have this fire break, phase four fire break. You know, it's a fire break. So, in all sobriety, I have to keep working on this because I'm still vulnerable to this too. We all are. You must, you know, not only denounce the brains behind all of the situation, not denounce that and reject it, but firebreak it. That's why Longchenpa is so helpful. It's like a fire marshal. He says, hey, look, you need to, this is how you can firebreak it. You know, this is a way. He says, do it. He's very, very keen about that, as is Jesus for sure. But Longchenpa tends to focus on phase four firebreaking exclusively. You know, he's in the Adi Yoga exclusively. Whereas Jesus has a broader mission, so to speak, of phase one, two, three, four, and five. And it's a little more diffuse, which is fine. I understand that. Longchenpa is very focused on this phase four firebreak. Gets you past all the pseudo-intellectualism, which is also pseudo-spiritualism, you know. And says, no, set it all down. Set down lies, set down, give up. Set down lies, set down truth, and relax into that. Abandon all lies, abandon all truth, and relax into that. Because truth, as we're seeing it pseudo-intellectually, they have their belief that truth, right? Because they can talk the talk. It means, of course, set down the concepts, the words, the path, the attainments, the outcomes, all of that. Set it down. Set it down. So we'll see if I can rally. I mean, it's something that has to take place. I do have to work a little bit today. I will keep trying here. Hopefully this message is getting through. All right, that's it.